Hey guys, welcome to Overpress. I'm Chris. We have a fun episode for you guys today. James Holzer is coming on the podcast. He is a content creator, actor, and podcast host. As they would say, a jack of all trades. He's a Swiss Army knife. And I think he will find out, he's doing a lot of things. He's here to talk about Formula One. We're going to talk a little bit about his acting career. And I, as a Formula One fan, I don't know if I'm a fan as much as I used to be. I used to be a pretty big fan of Formula One, and then Drive to Survive came out, and for some reason, my fanhood or fanship or fandom seemed to kind of diverge a little bit, and I started doing other things. Maybe I got too busy with Overcrest. I don't know what it was, but I kind of drifted off from being a fan. So we're going to explore that a little bit, find out how he, a total non-car guy, became a fan of Formula One. It's a pretty damn good conversation. Hope you guys enjoy it. FCP Euro is an online retailer of OEM, genuine aftermarket, and performance parts for European cars. From BMW to Porsche, Volvo, and more, their catalog is a one-stop shop with over 275,000 unique products, including expert-assembled kits to make shopping simpler. We just did a brake kit on the Golf R. Jesse changed her oil just the other day, got the whole kit done. She did it all herself. Watched some DIY videos on FCP's page that they released on YouTube. Awesome to make everything easy. They're actively building out the VW, Audi, and Porsche catalogs. From current to our favorite classics, including the Mark 1 Scirocco Freeride car, they are working to have every part you need for all of your cars. Plus, every product they sell is backed by a lifetime replacement guarantee, even wear items like wiper blades, brake pads, and oil filters. With the opening of their distribution center in Mesa, Arizona, FCP Euro is now shipping parts from both coasts, serving most of the country in just 3 days or less with free shipping option. We at Overcrest have been working with FCP Euro for years and can vouch for them. Real people who are passionate about what they do and the cars we love, while making sure they put you, the customer, first. Check them out today at fcpeuro.com and take advantage of free shipping on any order over $49. James, thanks so much for coming to help us on the podcast, man. I really appreciate you being here.
Thanks for having me. Always excited to talk.
I want to talk about a bunch of stuff, but there's one thing that, you know, we talked about earlier that really got me going, and it sent me down a rabbit hole, and I'm gonna play it for you. It is this, which little did I know, you were a Formula One fanatic, but also an actor in the new Matlock series. Dude, it sent me down this rabbit hole of all the shows that should be shows that aren't shows. Like, why don't we have, first of all, how did you get hooked up with being on Matlock?
So I need to preface that I'm only in one episode of Matlock, and it's like the 14th episode of the new season of the reboot.
Okay. Are you a murderer, or did you steal something? Are you
expert,
a bad guy?
I'm an expert witness in a court scene.
Okay. And, where are you an expert at?
I'm the head of compliance of like an energy drink company that has something to do with the case. But I will say that, the way this business works, like you could shoot something and then you end up getting cut out of the episode.
Yeah.
And shooting that episode, I shot it about a month ago, was my first time back on set in about 2 years, because you had the pandemic sort of slow the industry down a bit, but also there was a writers and an actor strike, which essentially caused the industry to come to a standstill for about a year. So I had not been on set in about 2 years, and I was very rusty, and it showed. And I think I was ultimately, at the end of the day, I was okay, but I was not my best. And I would not be surprised if they cut out or minimize my role.
You're a bad witness then, man. You're hurting the defense.
I was supposed to be an expert witness. And judging by my self-assessment of my performance, I was not very expertly, but that's on me. Acting is a muscle, and if you don't actively use it, you need to go back and exercise it. So I'm getting back into
it. What did rusty mean? What would that come across as? Was it just
butchering the lines? Like I've had a small parts in about a dozen TV shows, more or less. I also had a small part in a movie that premiered at Sundance this year titled Freaky Tales. I did improv and sketch comedy for over a decade in New York. I've, written and starred in like a number of my own things, whether they be like sketches or web series or whatnot. And, typically I'm like very sharp, pretty good at getting off book, reciting lines, but it just had been a very long time since I had been on set. I'm also juggling a lot of things. I You know, I have a full-time job as like a copywriter and a content creator at a bank. I also do this Formula One content creator thing where I record a podcast twice a week for WTF One.
Yep.
And I have a 3-year-old. And so I just have a lot going on. I booked this part. I spent 2 days getting off book, memorizing my lines, rehearsing over and over again. And I just showed up on set and I was really nervous. And I just, for the first time ever, I was nervous on set. And
that seems weird for a guy that does sketch comedy to be nervous, because that is all off the cuff.
Very weird. And it was really out of the norm for like what my experience usually is like on set. And I think it was just a wake up call that I needed to get back into like a rehearsal group and or an acting class just to get sharp again, because I think I'm just trying to do too much right now to the point where I'm not good at anything because I'm juggling so many things.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Well, I was thinking about the other shows that we need to bring back. For bringing back Matlock, which I'm 43 years old. So Matlock was what, late 80s, I think.
Yeah.
Is when Matlock was out. And I remember he was just like this jovial lawyer that would just kind of like help people out, you know. But I was thinking about all the other shows that were from back then and early 90s too. I think Married with Children should come back. I don't know if the guy who played Al Bundy is still alive, but man.
Yeah, he's totally alive. He was on Modern Family.
Grandpa. Oh, that's right. Grandpa Al Bundy. Grandpa Al Bundy. Can we do Grandpa Al Bundy? That would be great, right?
Yeah. You know, Ed O'Neill, this is a fun fact. You know, Ed O'Neill is like a classically trained actor. Like he has like a huge theater background. He's an incredible actor. And there is an interesting interview that you can go back and look at. And this was during the Married with Children days. And he was cast in like a prestige drama from like a big director. And I forget specifically what movie it was. And he was an expert witness or a witness in a courtroom scene. And when they showed the movie to focus groups, everybody laughed when he was on the stand because it's Al Bundy. And people just associate him with comedy. And he talked about how devastating that was, because I think the scene eventually got cut from the film. And he talked about how devastating that was because all he want, you know, for, you know, that his background is like, you know, doing theater. And so like for him to get an opportunity to do like a prestige dramatic film is what he wanted out of all this. And he kind of got pigeonholed into doing comedy. And I think
it was such an iconic show.
Yeah.
You know, like it's what are people supposed to do after that? That becomes who you are. They don't see Ed O'Neill. They see Al Bundy. That guy's walking around on the street. They see him as Al Bundy or the dude from Married with Children. They don't see him as a human being.
But then Modern Family came along and he was able to like do like something same but different. Like Modern Family is much more grounded. And I do feel the character he did on Modern Family had many more layers and dimensions than Al Bundy did. So I think that was in a way his redemption arc. He was able to show it was a blend of like his dramatic acting chops and his comedic prowess. So
what would you like to see him do? Is there any like what kind of role would you like to see him in?
I want to see Ed O'Neill do whatever he wants, like whatever his dream role is. I want him the opportunity to do it like the same way Bryan Cranston was the dad for Malcolm in the Middle until he did Breaking Bad. You know what I mean? Ed O'Neill deserves that.
I remember when Breaking Bad came out and I was thinking, dude, that's the guy from Malcolm in the Middle. I'm not watching that shit. And then, of course, it gets halfway through the season or season one is gone by and everybody's like, dude, you need to watch this show, which was Breaking Bad is obviously one of the most iconic shows of all time. But having that come out and him flipping that and being able to do that role is pretty incredible.
Absolutely. Yes.
No, it's all good. Dukes of Hazzard, which I don't know if we can bring back Dukes of Hazzard because they've got a Confederate flag on the car. But maybe
they did do a movie in the 2000s with Sean William Scott and Jessica Simpson. But yeah, you could bring that back, but you'd have to change the aesthetic of the car. What was it called? The General Lee?
General Lee had a big Confederate flag on the roof. I did a reel one time where I was like, oh man, this clip from Dukes of Hazzard is so good because he's talking about like going on an adventure and making whatever happen. I'm like, except there's a giant Confederate flag on the hood and I don't really want that in our social media. So I had to like crop out the Confederate flag and do all this creative stuff to make it work. But
You just cropped it so it's just an orange hood of like a Dodge Charger or whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. You got the guys in the car, jumping the car, and then it's kind of like the wheel on the side. And it looks a little pixelated because I had it didn't have any pixels to begin with because it's from the 80s. So when you take the not any pixels and make it even less pixels, that's pretty much what you end up with. Also, A-Team. I'd like to bring back the A-Team show, which
who,
I don't know. Wait,
who is your modern-day B.A. Baracus, though?
I have no idea. A lot of those guys, I don't think you could recast, I guess, huh?
I think of like The Rock, but I feel like The Rock is way bigger than Mr. T ever was. And The Rock also has more range than Mr. T ever did. So I'm trying to think of like who is like sort of a cartoonish like character who is also an actor or somebody in media that could be that character. And I can't think of someone like that.
Yeah, I saw Mr. T at an airport just sitting there. Just like waiting for whatever flight he was waiting for, just sitting there. Yeah, he's not a big dude. The Rock is way too big, man.
Yeah, I pity the fool who has to travel in premium economy.
Yeah, especially if you're the size of The Rock. Also, Magnum PI, obviously great.
They brought that back. That's on CBS right now. The star is I forget the guy's name.
Dude, Magnum PI. I don't know. The problem is that it was network television, so then I never saw it like come up on my. You should watch this. Algorithmic spoon fed content consumption.
So it was on the air from 2018 to 2024, and it starred Jay Hernandez.
Hernandez is. Well, maybe that name sounds familiar. And the only other one was MacGyver, obviously. And
which they also brought back.
Did they?
They brought it back like 10 years ago.
Okay, so it didn't work because I didn't hear
I think it lasted like three seasons.
Like what other show?
CBS loves recycling was like IP.
The MacGyver. Like, what other show has a word that people still use today as, like, an adverb for their life? Like, MacGyver. You don't love boat something. You can MacGyver something, but you don't love boat something. What does love boat something even mean?
You fill it with a bunch of horny people and see what happens.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what every reality show now is. You love boat it. You throw a bunch of people who have main character energy and force them to be part of an ensemble. And then you give them alcohol and see what happens.
Yeah, that's sad. I watched there was a show where they put everybody on a boat and you probably won't even be able to guess what show this is because it defines every show, but they put everybody on a boat and then they made them go do like tasks out on the beach or swim. And then they would have to vote somebody off the island.
And that might've been one of that might've been one of the Road Rules Real World MTV All-Stars shows they did.
Maybe it was on Netflix or something like that.
Okay.
Anyway. So I called you a little bit earlier today. And we talked a little bit. Are you into cars outside of Formula One? I want to kind of shift into Formula One now and kind of get to the tax of it.
Yeah.
Are you into cars outside of Formula One?
Yeah, I need to warn you because I listened to a bunch of episodes already of this show, like especially the one with Andy Bellet, the wind tunnel engineer for, I believe he works for Visa Cash App RB.
Yes.
I know you have like a lot of shorthand and stuff when you're talking about cars. I know absolutely nothing about cars. So, you know, I just need to preface that before we get any deeper into this conversation, because like I said before, you start like dropping terminology left and right. I'm going to have no idea what you're talking about. You may as well be speaking like a foreign language that I've never heard of.
How does
like,
this happen?
What do you mean? How does this happen?
No. Not everybody's into cars. I understand that. But how does somebody that is not into cars and isn't a car guy become a prolific Formula One commentator?
Well, I think I'm not a commentator. I'm just like a content creator.
If you are looking for the best app for navigating your next adventure, look no further than OnX Off-Road. With over 750,000 miles of trails and comprehensive offline maps, you can explore without worrying about cell service. The app features trail ratings, detailed information, and a discover tool to help you find trails near you. OnX Off-Road also includes public and private land boundaries, so you'll always know where you can legally off-road, and camp. Plan trips with ease using our route builder and share your adventures with friends. With features like route tracking, waypoint marking, and real-time updates, you're equipped for any challenge. Ready to start your next adventure with confidence? Try OnX Off-Road free for 7 days. Download today and start exploring.
And people are going to roll their eyes and like him and Ha when they hear this, but it's because of Drive to Survive. And I know,
oh, man.
And I know people like Andy Bellette and maybe people like you and other people who have been into Formula One or into cars for a long time aren't a big fan of Drive to Survive. You know, I do feel like at times it does sensationalize things. It does dramatize things to make it more industry interesting to the casual viewer. It definitely takes liberties with the truth to craft specific narratives. But that was my entry into Formula One. You know, my wife and I were holed up in our house during the pandemic. We had nothing to watch. Like a lot of people, we turned on Drive to Survive. We're immediately hooked, got really into it, and started, you know, burning through all the seasons to the point where the first race I ever watched was the Australian Grand Prix last year, which was like the third race of the season. So I'm very new to this. And I started making, I fell ass backwards into being an F1 content creator because my wife and I made one video as a joke. And it was, we don't even have a nice car. We drive a Prius. And so I'm driving the Prius around and my wife is-
It's a hybrid.
It's a hybrid. And my wife
more
is-
More in common with a Formula One car than anything I've got.
Exactly. And so my wife is in the passenger seat and she's filming me and we're doing team talk. So she's pretending like she's the race engineer and I'm the driver and we're talking back and forth as if we're doing team radio. And it was just like a joke thing. And it's intersectional in the way where it like it blends Formula One humor and it's also like couples humor, you know? So I made this video. I put it out on my Instagram, not thinking anything of it. I'm like, all right, maybe I'll get like a couple hundred likes. And it went super viral. It had like 8 million views on Instagram. It had like 5 million views on TikTok. It was shared by ESPN, Sports Illustrated, Motorsport.com. And all of a sudden, all these people started following me. And I was like, okay, I still have footage from that shoot. Let me cut up like 3 more versions of this video. So I did that. All of those went viral. So I was like, okay, what else can I do in this F1 space that people would find funny? And I made a video comparing Formula One teams to NFL franchises. And that went viral. And then I was like, okay, I'll do one more and I'll compare Formula One drivers to Mario Kart characters. And that went viral. And all of a sudden, all these people start following me for the F1 stuff that I'm making. And so I told myself, okay, I will keep making Formula One videos until they stop getting engagement. And then they never did. And within the span of a year, I went from 3,000 followers on Instagram to 96,000. And I've like painted myself into this corner of being a Formula One content creator. Cause whenever I tried to make a video about anything else, nobody gave a shit.
Yeah. Yeah. That's tough. I know some other content creators that are in the same space where every time they try to step out of their lane, mm-hmm. the algorithm just crushes them. They're just like, nope. Algorithm just hates them.
The only exception where that has worked is when I've done content about other motorsport series. Like I was hired by Formula E last season for season 10 to be a content creator for them. And there were a few videos I did that did fairly well for them. Also, I made some stuff about the 24-hour of Le Mans, which people were really into, as well as IndyCar. So as long as I stay in like the motorsport space, the stuff I do, like the stuff I make does pretty well. The one exception was when the Olympics were around about a month ago, I made 4 videos about the Olympics that did very well. And I think that was just because it was like a universal experience. The whole world mm-hmm. was watching.
Yep.
And I was kind of answering a lot of the questions that people had about like weird intricacies of different sports happening in the Olympics. But typically I have to make F1 stuff or motorsport stuff or nobody cares.
Yeah. So how did you go from, I like Drive to Survive and I'm going to make a few reels and TikToks to actually, are you actually into Formula One now? Do you watch the races?
Yeah.
Do you enjoy? Okay. So how do you make that? What was it about Formula One that when you started to watch the races really drew you in? What sucked you into being a fan versus, you know, just following the narrative of something like Drive to Survive?
It was the people. Like I care about it because of the human element of it. And like, yes, often I find the racing exciting, but it's becoming attached to the people and the teams and the drama that's happening behind the scenes and the history that exists behind the teams and the relationships, their relationships with one another that made me so interested. So, you know, I often get like a lot of gatekeepy like comments or people commenting on my stuff saying, oh, you're just doing this to make money, or you're just doing this for attention, or this is just a grab to get followers. I'm like, no, I'm a fan. I wake up at like 4 a.m. to watch the Azerbaijan Grand Prix in Baku. I watch every single race in live time. I don't like record it and then wake up at like 9 a.m. and watch it afterwards. I try to watch all the practice sessions. I watch every qualifying session. Like, Drive to Survive made me a fan, and I immediately got into it and started watching, and I haven't stopped. And a lot of the videos that I make or the commentary that I make on my Instagram and TikTok, I'd be making to my friends anyway. I'd be making with my wife anyway. So I'm like, why don't I just put that POV out into the world and see what happens? And then also, there is a misconception that Formula One or motorsport content creators make money, which is insane. Like, I do this because I like it. And that's, I'm just like sharing my enthusiasm for the sport. There are very few, there's like a handful of content creators who make enough money to not have to have a day job. And I am not one of them. I make like a little bit of money sometimes when someone asks me to do a branded thing, but it's like a side thing. It's a side hustle. I'm mainly just doing it because I enjoy it.
It's weird. It's the reverse for me. So I used to watch a bunch of the races, you know, years and years ago. I would sign up for whatever thing it was, whether it was, you know, the Formula One thing, or whether it was like, I think it was on ESPN or like NBC or something, had it for a year. And then Drive to Survive came out, and I found myself watching Drive to Survive and then not watching the races. So I was like the inverse. Like, once Drive to Survive came out, I love that show. I might be like, I'm a minority maybe, but I love that show.
I love that show. I think it's amazing.
So then I quit watching the races because I was like, well, I don't necessarily want Drive to Survive to be spoiled by watching the races. Like, I don't want to. It's totally the inverse of you, I think.
You're like, no spoilers. I don't want to know who won. I'm going to wait till February of next year when the season drops.
It's kind of that way. So normally, like this year, I don't have any of the subscription stuff. I'm not watching any of the races, the first time that I haven't done anything. And it feels a little bit weird. I feel kind of out of it. You know, prepping for this, I went through it. I was kind of stunned by all this news. I'm like, wow, Red Bull's not dominating. McLaren's right there. Holy shit. Now I feel like I'm really missing out. Now that we're towards the, you know, what are we, 3/4 of the way through the season now, or if not more?
Let me tell you something. You are absolutely missing out, Chris. This season is, I think, and yes, I've only been watching Formula One for like a year and a half, but like since I've gotten into it, I've gotten obsessed with the history. I've gotten somewhat familiar with sort of the arcs of the different teams' dominance and the different eras. This season is one of the best seasons of Formula One in the last few decades. So far, we have 7 different race winners from 4 different constructors. We have Charles Leclerc winning at his home race in Monaco for the first time. We have Ferrari winning at Monza. We have a first career win for Lando Norris, a first career win for Oscar Piastri. We have an emotional home race win for Lewis Hamilton at Silverstone in his last British Grand Prix for the Silver Arrows. A very close fight for the Constructors' Championship. A close fight for the Drivers' Championship. George Russell, like, winning a race and then yelling yabba-dabba-doo on the radio. We have what appears to be now like a very mortal and more mature Max Verstappen. A driver switch mid-season. A silly season where we have 3 rookies announced for next season. A race ban from Kevin Magnussen. And a partridge in a pear tree. This has been a crazy season so far. And we still have like 8 races left.
Yeah, it seems like from what I read, I'm like, damn, I am really, really, really missing out. And it kind of bums me out because it's almost like too late. You don't want to watch.
No, nah, jump in. Come on, the water's fine.
So do you think the narrative stuff has affected the sport itself at all? Do you think has it seeped into, when I mean narrative stuff, I mean Drive to Survive and maybe some social media and stuff that you're doing, right? Like podcasts and TikToks and social. Has it affected what happens on the ground at the track? Or are they immune? Just want to take a quick break to talk about the Drivers Club. If you'd like, you can support this podcast by going to www. I don't know why I always do that. Go to overcrestproductions.com/Drivers Club. You can support this show for just $5, $10, $25 a month. Anything helps. We really appreciate it. You can get t-shirts, prints, A little bird told me that Jake is going to be coming back in the fall, which is awesome. We have a lot of exclusive content there. I know a lot of you haven't heard it. There's, I think, maybe 20 episodes that are available as exclusive Drivers Club only episodes. If you want to hear those, all kinds of history stuff, some really fun things. My interview with Akim from Bugatti, the head of design, is there. There's an interview with Adam Carolla that's there that I did. There's a bunch of good stories from Jake as well. You can go to overcrestproductions.com/drivers club and support this show. It costs $5, guys. Everybody that listens threw up $5 instead of getting one Red Bull or one coffee. You would be supporting a good thing. And like I always say, if you don't support us, find something that you love to support. You know, it's hard being a creator out here. It's difficult. It takes a lot of work. We put a lot of blood, sweat, and tears into all of this. Your support would be much appreciated. Overcrestproductions.com/drivers club.
I think a lot of these drivers are so expertly media trained that they are so good at canceling out a lot of the noise that happens around them. I think the one adverse effect of all of this that is a negative for the drivers themselves is that I think they have there's a lot more expectation for them to be available to the social and comms teams for the teams that they drive of. And I think they're expected to do more in regards of being an entertainer when a lot of them just want to be a driver.
Right.
And so, you know, I think there's a lot of good that's come from the popularity of Drive to Survive and the new audience it's brought in. And there's also a lot of bad. Like, there are a lot of drivers like Max Verstappen, who's, you know, very similar to Kimi Raikkonen in the sense that, like, all they want to do is drive. They don't want to do any of the other shit that comes along with it. Like, they just want to drive a car and that's it. And some of the drivers are more agreeable and willing to be a part of the show and willing to do the appearances and willing to, like, do the silly TikToks and willing to do the extra interviews. And I think it's probably required a much greater demand on the drivers in regards to their bandwidth.
Yeah. I think this stuff is almost required now, as you kind of have to do it just because of the way money is made.
Yeah.
In the world. Right. I mean, there's, you can't, it's not just like it's syndicated on television anymore. And the logos on the cars and the banners at the race, that's what pays the bills.
Yeah.
Now there's a whole different way that everything is consumed. So if you know, these guys aren't making themselves available to social media, these companies get buried. These race teams get buried. They don't get mentioned. They don't get seen. And then, you know, everybody's pissed off. The partners are pissed off. Sponsors are pissed off.
A lot of it has to do with, you know, it often has to do with partnerships with specific teams. Like, Logan Sargeant was just replaced with Franco Colapinto, who's an Argentinian driver.
That bums me out big time, man. Oh, yeah. Man, that bums me out. I didn't know that. That bums me out.
Yeah, so he was replaced, and Franco Colapinto's first race was last week. Sorry, spoiler, Chris. I should have said spoiler alert before I said it.
That's okay.
A lot of people were wondering, like, why are you placing a rookie with another rookie? Why didn't you put, like, an experienced driver in there? Someone who you know is not going to bin it, who's not going to be a financial liability. And then we started finding out more about the partnerships that were announced after that driver announcement happened. And we found out that Globant became an official partner of Williams Racing for the remainder of the season. And Globant is a company that was found in Argentina, who has been a longtime supporter of Franco Colapinto. So, like, you know, you connect the dots and you see it. It's always kind of been like this, but now it's even more so. Like, how marketable is your driver on top of how good are they on the track?
That kind of sucks a little bit, man. I'll be honest.
It's always kind of been like that, though. You see old interviews with Eddie Jordan, you know, founder of Jordan Grand Prix. And he talked about a driver that he absolutely loved. And I forget the guy's name. I have it in my notes somewhere. But it's a driver that he absolutely loved, who had won a couple Grand Prix for Jordan. And he wanted to keep him in that seat for the next season. But at the time, Jordan was partnered with Honda. And Honda really wanted a Japanese driver. And so they're like, we really want you to put Takuma Sato in that seat. Takuma Sato is a great driver. But at the time, Eddie Jordan was like, I really like this driver. I'd like to keep him. However, Honda was willing to pay that seat's salary if it was a Japanese driver. And so Eddie Jordan was like, I love this other driver, but not enough to cost me 18 million pounds.
Yeah. So you don't love him that much.
Yeah, I'm going to let Honda dictate that Takuma Sato gets a seat, and Takuma Sato got that seat. And that's just like how it's always been. However, I think we're seeing it more, not just from like engine suppliers. We're seeing it from sponsors willing to, you know, be a part of a team. If as long as the driver that they want is there. And that kind of happened, I think, also at Ferrari in the early 2010s, where Fernando Alonso or Kimi Raikkonen ended up not having a seat at Ferrari because Banco Santander wanted to be a sponsor of Ferrari, but they wanted Fernando Alonso in a seat. And so Kimi Raikkonen ended up being an odd man out because Felipe Massa also had a sponsorship deal with Ferrari. And so he was got to stay in that seat. And even though Kimi Raikkonen was the most recent Ferrari World Drivers Champion in 2007, he was kind of left SOL and without a seat for the year.
Yeah, I mean, it's corporate nepotism and it's, you know, there's familial nepotism too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know,
I don't think Schumacher's kid gets a shot if he's not Schumacher's kid, because he really wasn't that good. You know, there's no way that guy gets all the shots he got without that.
It's interesting because he's a decent endurance driver and he's done pretty well for Alpine in WEC. And, you know, they had him and Jack Doohan do a test to see if Mick Schumacher was worthy of that second Alpine seat. And they gave it to Jack Doohan, who is their currently their reserve driver. And Jack Doohan sort of won out, I think, in that test. A lot of people argue that Mick Schumacher had a bad shake and a bad deal at Haas. It wasn't the right conditions, but I think you're probably right. I don't think he ever would have gotten that opportunity initially if he hadn't been the son of one of the greatest, if not the greatest driver in Formula One history.
Yeah, for sure. And what do you think of the Mario Andretti situation?
You mean Andretti trying to join the Formula One grid?
Yeah, man. I was super bummed. I mean, I'll be honest. When we were doing a bunch of news episodes last year and that kept coming up and then it got completely shut down, dude, I was kind of crestfallen as an American fan.
Over crestfallen.
That's right. Absolutely. I was over crestfallen.
I think Formula One should have 12 teams. I think there is room for 12 teams on the grid. I think 10.
How many are there now?
There's 10.
What is there?
There's 10. Okay. But there's been times where there were 26 cars in the grid. Or there had been like, I think there were even times way back when where there were like in the 30s, but like only the top 20 qualified for the race or the top 26 qualified for the race. I think there's room for 12 teams on the grid. I think 10 is not enough. I also think there is so much incredible talent in the world and drivers that deserve a shot in Formula One. And when you only have 20 spots on the grid, you have a lot of drivers that never get an opportunity. You have Teo Porcher, former Formula 2 champion, might never drive in Formula 1 because the timing's just never been right. You have people like Felipe Drugovich, Frederik Vesti. You have right now at McLaren, you have like McLaren has this embarrassment of riches where like they have Oscar and Lando, who arguably could be at McLaren for another 10 years, and they have an F2 driver in Gabriel Bortoleto, who's like an incredible Brazilian driver who might not find a seat. So I think adding four more spots to the grid would solve and alleviate some of those issues because there's just such an incredible bottleneck when it comes to Formula One that there should be 12 teams.
Well, as there should be a bottleneck, that's the pinnacle, right?
I mean, sure. It,
the same thing is you can't have everybody racing Formula One. So at some point you have to be like, that's enough. That's it.
Correct. But I do think there isn't enough turnover. I think generally, if you're a driver in Formula One and you've been there for a few years and it's gotten to the point where it's very clear you don't have what it takes to ever contend for a championship, even if you got an opportunity at a top team, you probably should get turned over and someone who's waiting in the winch should get plugged in.
It sounds like legislation we need in the federal government for the Supreme Court or something.
They've talked about age limits. They've talked about age limits in the government and in Supreme Court, and I think they should be. Like, you know, you get to the point, like, you've been there long 100%. Enough. Like, you've shown that you haven't been able to make that much of an impact. Let's move on and give it to someone who's waiting in the wings and young and hungry.
Yeah, if you haven't won a podium in how many? Two seasons? No podiums? Three seasons? Come on, man. The thing is that all these dudes are so... When you look at how good they are, it's easy to be like, oh, well, you know, Mick Schumacher wasn't very good. Dude's incredible.
Yeah.
Realistically, like in context, maybe didn't perform very well. But when you look at the time and stuff like that, this dude is absolutely incredible. You and I, if we got in one of these cars, would just be dead.
Yeah.
We would just kill ourselves. But these guys are so good. And how many of these dudes are so good? I think you're right. I think turnover would be great if we could have some sort of 2-year, 3-year, no podium thing. Maybe we could get some new blood in there.
If you are good enough to get into the Formula One grid and drive a Formula One car, then you objectively are a good driver.
Yeah.
It's easy for us to armchair quarterback it and say like, oh, Logan Sargeant is trash. But the truth is like Logan Sargeant was very competitive in the lower feeder series and, you know, came to Formula One, but like you look at the times and he's still not that far off from like the people in P1, P2, P3. It's just, he's further down the grid.
It's just so, how it is.
Yeah.
It's like a couple of neurons that he's missing. Just like 2 or 3 of our billions of neurons in our head. Just they're not there in Logan. They are in some of the other guys.
A lot of it has to do with their split second reaction time, which is like, yes, you can improve it to a degree with exercises, but some people just have it and some people don't.
Right. You ever seen the ones where a snake tries to attack a cat?
No.
You ever seen those? Yeah. It's like the reaction time of a cat is incredible. Like a snake is fast. Dude, yeah. I almost got eaten alive by a rattlesnake like a month ago. I was walking on a trail and there was a giant rattlesnake. It's about this big around and it was sitting in a rock and it wasn't moving. And as I was walking by it, I kind of looked over and saw it. But humans are not fast enough. Like most humans are fast enough. If that snake were to jump out at me, it would just bite me. I wouldn't be able to react in time. But I saw this video of a slow motion of just like an orange cat. And orange cats are notoriously stupid. They're just dumb cats. But this orange cat is sitting there and there's this snake. And the snake like launches out at this cat and the cat just raises its paw, just like smacks its head down. Just boom, like this instant reaction time.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, not everybody can be a cat. Most of us are just snakes.
Yeah. To quote the movie Aristocats, everybody wants to be a cat.
That's right. So what makes a good race in your mind let me say what I think is a good race. And you can tell me what you think is a good race. I think a good race is competitive. A lot of people will think a good race is there's exciting crashes and things go wrong and there's an or fire, or someone gets hurt. Like a lot of people are really into the danger of it. And I am to a point where I feel like risk is important to have, but it's not what I want to see. I want to see 2 guys, 3 guys, 4 guys duking it out for a points position. It doesn't even have to be first place. I don't need to see guys at the top duking it out for first, second, third place. I don't need to see the podium stuff. If someone is in 5th, 6th, or 7th and those guys are duking it out for like 10 laps, I'm into it. That's a good race for me. AC Solutions offers complete plug-and-play air conditioning conversion kits for your classic BMW, such as the E30, God's Chariot, the E28 and E24, and soon to be Porsche. Featuring OEM quality components with period correct finishes and materials, their products are designed as a drop-in upgrade to your old factory system, but with performance of modern technology. Their products stem from hands-on design and development with a deep knowledge and passion for these vehicles. I know Austin sits there and just crushes all the ideas in his head and just mires them down into a focal point and brings out the best possible version of his air conditioning products. Everything is well designed. They're designed by enthusiasts for enthusiasts and complete with a full warranty, quality instructions, mirroring those of a factory manual. Check out all their offerings at acsolutions.co. That's acsolutions.co. Petrolbox is a monthly service made specifically for the automotive enthusiast. Each month, they carefully select items including tools, detailing supplies, apparel, garage gear, stickers, and publications to be sent right to your doorstep. It's a curated selection of the latest and greatest gear in the industry. There are actually 2 different levels of subscription to choose from. The Petrobox Basic costs less than $20 a month, while the Petrobox Premium gets you more gear for $39.95 a month. Check them out at mypetrobox.com and be sure to use the code OVERCREST at checkout to get $6 off your first month.
For me,
what is your definition of it?
So I do not like crashes. I'm not one of those people in any motorsport. I do not like to see people crash. I do not get any joy out of it. I feel terrible for the team that has to repair that car. I feel terrible for the driver who gets put in that dangerous situation. Crashes do not excite me. Some people get excited about it. I'm not one of them. I think.
Is there anything in your mind about going back into vintage racing and seeing all the risk and crashes like that? Do you have a, Is there any romantic sense? A lot of people have a romantic, what is it? There's a term for it. It's like animosa or something like that. Or there's a word that starts with A. I don't know what the word is because I'm not a brilliant person. But it's basically having nostalgia for a time that you were never part of there's a term for it.
No, I don't have that. I do. There is something very romantic about some of the older eras of Formula One, but I think that is just, you know, I think people constantly love looking back at different eras in history, regardless of what, you know, sport or field you're talking about. And you look at it through these rose colored glasses, because you're just really looking at the highlights. You're not like thinking about the reality of it. You're not thinking about how terribly unreliable these cars were.
The V10 era was so great and all this stuff, when like Ferrari was walking away with everything and the races were really, really boring.
Yeah.
People glorify this period of time when the racing was really not interesting. The cars sounded cool, of course, and the cars were cool, but the racing was inherently boring.
Yeah. So for me, what an exciting race happens, there's like a misconception that a lot of overtakes makes an exciting race. I don't necessarily think that's 100% true. I do think you want overtakes. What I like to see in an exciting race to me is some like close wheel-to-wheel battles for position, whether it's at the top of the grid, or the middle of the grid, or the back of the grid. I don't care. I just want to see, I want to see some close wheel-to-wheel action. I just also want to see a close race. And I also don't want it just to come down to the driver's ability to drive the car. I want strategy to get thrown into it. I like to see two-stop races.
Define strategy for me quick.
Sure. You
know, what is strategy when you talk? Because I just think of as like I'll call myself a regular dude, a casual fan. I think strategy, I'm just like, what tires are we running today?
Yeah.
To me, that's what strategy is. But there's got to be more to it than that, right?
But it's not just what tires you're running, because as you know, as a Formula One fan, when you have to use two different compounds of tires in a race, it's a rule. So every race has to be at the very least a one-stop race. You'll have a race like you saw at Azerbaijan last year at Baku, where all the cars could have driven on hards the entire race and not stopped and still had enough grip on the tires to finish the race, but they all have to stop at least once. Esteban Ocon drove the entire race at Baku last year, hoping for a safety car so he could pit on a safety car and come out ahead of everyone. And the safety car never happened. So he ended up having to pit on like the second to last lap. And by that time, people didn't realize that all the cars hadn't pitted yet. So there were a bunch of reporters and photographers in the pit lane, and he almost hit them. It was a pretty scary moment. So when I talk about strategy, I talk about what compound is each car going to start on? Is it going to be a one-stop race or a two-stop race or a three-stop race? Also, are we going to try to undercut the other teams? Are we going to try to pit first and for our first and second pit stops ahead of the other teams? Or are we going to go for the overcut? Are we going to try to stay out longer and extend our time? And so I'm fascinated with the strategy aspect because it adds so many more variables into the race as opposed to just the driver's ability. The variables include how fast the pit crew can do a stop and change the tires. Also, what time at what lap the race engineer and the strategist decides you're going to come in for that stop. Also, what compound are we going to switch to? Are we going to try to go really long on these hards and then at the very end go for softs and try to go for fastest lap? Or are we going to start on a medium and then do a medium and then do a soft? Or are we going to start on a medium to have a little more grip than the other cars and then halfway through the race just end it on hards and try to go long on the hards? So
one of the strategy things cool too is when one driver has one strategy and the other driver has another strategy. And often they become at odds with each other.
Yeah.
And someone's legitimately upset because their strategy sucks.
Yeah.
And their teammate's strategy worked out.
Yeah. We see that for sure. We saw that at Spa this year at the Belgian Grand Prix. George Russell decided to stay out on a one stop and he drove his hard tires on, I believe, like 10 or 15 laps longer than anybody else did and ended up winning the race. Then he ended up getting disqualified because I think the car was under the minimum weight by like 1.5 kilograms. But Lewis Hamilton finished
that's
second.
Almost nothing.
It's almost nothing. But
what is, that? Is that like this? That's like this much? Is this 1.5 kilograms and half a glass of water?
Maybe,
like,
yeah.
That's nothing.
It's like 3 pounds and change or something like that. But I think the reasoning was at Spa, they don't get to do a cool down lap. And most cars get to do a cool down lap after a Grand Prix. And yep. What they do is you'll see them like going off the racing line when they're doing their cool down lap and they're picking up the marbles on the track. They're
picking up all
the loose rubber. And by picking up that loose rubber, they add a lot of weight to the car. And right. At Spa, you don't do that because the track is so long. And so a lot of people speculate that they had factored in the cool down lap and then remembered, we don't have a cool down lap. So the car was underweight. But the point I'm trying to make is at the time, George Russell had won that race because they decided to do a one stop. Lewis Hamilton, his teammate, did a two stop and was kind of upset with the engineers being like, I feel like we should have stayed out. I talked about staying out and then we didn't. And then I ended up not winning the race and my teammate did. So what's going on here? And then eventually he did win the race because George Russell was DQ'd. But you do see that happen where the other driver ends up getting a strategy that was advantageous and the other driver feels like they were left out.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so you're into the strategy. That's what does it for you. Is it even more than the racing itself, even more than the duking it out is the strategy?
I think it's everything. Like I love the rumors that are going on behind the scenes. I love all of the storylines that are happening with the drivers and the team principals and the drama that's happening, like about silly season, about what's going to happen next season with some of these drivers who like are trying to prove themselves to stay in a seat or they're about to leave. So this is like their last season with the team. Like I love all of it. It's like watching a play and knowing all of the drama with the actors and the writers and the directors, and then you're seeing it like play out on stage. I don't know.
Right. Yeah. It's good shit. You're making me feel really, really bad for not paying any attention at all. So did you go to the Vegas Grand Prix?
I did not.
Did you go?
You know, I love F1. I have not been to a race yet.
Why not?
It's mainly because it's super expensive. It's cost prohibitive for a lot of people. And I did some work.
Of the cost for some of the tickets at the Las Vegas thing and what they were doing. Like if you had a restaurant that overlooked the track,
yeah,
you had to pay like some exorbitant fee. Otherwise you had to paint your windows over black or something like that. So nobody could see. It was brutal, man.
Yeah. I would love to go to a race, and I did do some work with the Miami Grand Prix this year. I made some sponsored videos to help sell tickets, and they gave me some GA passes, and I wanted to go, but scheduling wise, I just couldn't pull it off with childcare and things like that. So I can't go. I was.
What about a press pass, man? Can't you get a press pass?
Maybe. I don't know. Sports and also politics are starting to give more media credentials to content creators, but yeah. I have not requested that yet. I've been to races. I mean, I've been to 3 Formula E E-Prix or Formula E races. I've been to 1 IndyCar race. I went to the IndyCar Grand Prix in Long Beach, which was really fun. But I haven't been to an F1 race yet. I don't think I'm going to be able to go to COTA because of scheduling issues. My wife's going to be out of town. I got to watch my kid. So possible that I could make it to Las Vegas.
I think the podcast is your big carrot for them. You know, a content creator, great, but if you've got a lot of people listening to the WTF1 podcast,
I don't know. I may or may not get in trouble for saying this, but like being the host of the WTF1 podcast is like being in the second seat at Red Bull. It is a poison chalice. And I say that because it is an impossible task in the sense that it used to be hosted by Matt and Tommy, who everyone knows now as P1 with Matt and Tommy. And Matt and Tommy were the hosts of the WTF1 podcast for years. And they helped along with other verticals and shows at the race media, build the WTF1 brand and build that WTF1 audience. And when they decided to leave and start their own thing, which is P1 with Matt and Tommy, a lot of the audience at WTF1 just left and followed them to P1 with Matt and Tommy. And they're really good. They are very good hosts. Their podcast is very good. They're almost always first to market. They record right after a race, and their race review is usually up on Spotify and Apple Podcasts like an hour and a half, 2 hours after a race. They don't go on tangents. They strictly talk business. So their podcasts are relatively short and easy to keep up with and follow. And they're just like, they're what brands want out of a Formula One content creator, because they are over-enthusiastic British nerds who rarely have anything mean to say. Like, they will be critical, but they're not mean. And so they left, and there's been like a revolving door of hosts at the WTF1 podcast. And a lot of people have a similar experience that I have, where they show up, they're excited to be the host of this podcast that has like a million subscribers on YouTube and 900,000 followers on Instagram. And then they see the comments, and the comments are, "You're not Matt and Tommy. Where are Matt and Tommy? Wow, this place has really gone downhill since Matt and Tommy left. Wow, this place has gone to crap." And you're like, "Oh, okay, this is what I've signed up for."
Well, what did they expect? If you want that, go listen to the other thing and appreciate that there's something new as well.
100%. And in the guy that I host with it now is Hayden Gullis. He is a sim racer who is a content creator and a huge Formula One fan, encyclopedic knowledge of Formula One, but also spends a lot of time streaming, playing F1 24, doing iRacing, things like that. And he and I get along really well. We've been doing it for about 3 or 4 months now. And I really enjoy recording the episodes with him and talking Formula One with him, but it remains to be seen whether the audience will ever accept us as anything but if you ordered Matt and Tommy off of Temu. You know what I mean?
Well, maybe let's call it Amazon. Let's order it off of Amazon. Temu, that's, that's always a resale shop. At least you guys aren't resale. I listened to a couple episodes in preparation for this. I thought it was interesting. Okay. I don't necessarily, as like a casual guy, I don't want to listen to a breakdown of the race. I want to listen to something that's fun and entertaining.
Yeah.
So I'm probably a different type of audience. So I think it would be, in terms of audience capture, which can sometimes be a negative term, but I think in terms of audience capture, I think you could, I think it's pretty good. I think you're a funny guy.
Thanks.
So you mentioned Formula E a second ago.
Yeah.
And then you did some stuff for Formula E and you went to some races. So I'm curious. All the things that they do in Formula E, I feel like they're kind of a gimmick, right? There's all these different zones and these different things that happen in Formula E. And I don't know if it's to make it interesting or to make it different or whatever, but is there anything you see that Formula E does that should be applied to Formula One in terms of what Formula E is doing to make Formula One more interesting? Because I feel like Formula E, if you don't like racing, let's say you're a person that doesn't care about cars and you're going to watch something, I feel like Formula E, not knowing any of the personalities, the drama, all this stuff, let's just look at just the racing. Formula E could potentially be more interesting, the way that the races are built.
I agree. I think it's similar in the case. It's similar to IndyCar in that you see a lot of pack racing because a lot of the strategy is about energy conservation. In IndyCar, it's like fuel save and also tire save, but the main strategy in Formula E is energy conservation, because the battery really only gives you enough power to drive for 45 minutes to an hour. So you can't drive flat out the entire race, or you're going to run out of battery and you're not going to be able to finish.
Right.
And I think the things that Formula E does well that Formula One could learn from, that they probably will not, because it's all about making money in the bottom line. Formula E is incredibly accessible. It's very affordable. You show up to a race. There are tons of areas and fan activations that fans can enjoy. And when I went to Mexico City for round one Formula E, and I also went to rounds 13 and 14 in Portland, I made a point to spend a few hours interviewing fans and talking to fans for a few segments. And I didn't meet one fan who was having a bad experience at Formula E. They were all happy to be there. They all felt like they were getting a lot of bang for their buck. They felt like they were being appreciated as fans. There was lots to do aside from just going to their grandstand seat and watching the race. You go to a Formula One race, and I haven't been there yet, but this is what people have told me from their experience. You know, you buy a GA pass or you buy a grandstand pass. Everywhere you turn, there's an area that you aren't allowed to go to.
You aren't allowed to go.
You are not rich enough, or cool enough. So you don't have the right lanyard. You don't have the right pass. You don't have the right bracelet or whatever. So I think Formula E does a great job in being incredibly accessible. Also, as a fan, it's easy to follow because everything happens in one day. You have free practice, qualifying, and the race all happens in a day. And the race is only 45 minutes to an hour long. So you have a lot of people who don't watch NASCAR because NASCAR is 36 races a year, and a NASCAR race can last 4 hours.
That's why I don't watch baseball. It's the same thing. There's too many, or hockey.
Yeah.
Like I'll watch a baseball game. I can enjoy sitting now, especially once they put a clock on the guy that on the pitcher. Made it a lot better. And I can watch a hockey game.
Yeah.
But I can't watch a whole season of that shit.
Sure.
There's too many games. It takes too long. I can't follow that. Who's got time for that?
100%. Yeah. You know, so I think the efficiency and how you can essentially follow everything, even if you just want to watch the race, it's an hour of your day. So I think that is something that Formula E does very well that the other series don't. Like, I think an average Formula One Grand Prix is around 2 hours. And I think that was dictated by Bernie Ecclestone when he took over at Formula One. And it was for the same reasons. It's for like, we want it to be around 2 hours because that's what most people have the attention span for.
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's, movies are 2 hours too. You get a 3 hour movie. There's probably like this graph where you could draw with length of movie and box office dollars made. The longer the movie is, the less money it makes at the box office. Probably too with the shorter movie. No one's going to go watch a movie that's 50 minutes because it isn't worth your time.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So, are there women? There's women in Formula E, right? Racing.
There are some drivers who have tested for teams. So Jamie Chadwick tested for Formula E team, as well as Marta Garcia Lopez, who was a F1 Academy champion, I believe, tested with ERT, one of the Formula E teams. There is not a female driver on the Formula E grid right now, but there might be soon. I know Jamie Chadwick in September is testing with Andretti for IndyCar. And if you're listening and you don't know who Jamie Chadwick is, she's a W Series champion, which is the predecessor to F1 Academy, which was an all-female single-seater racing series. Jamie Chadwick currently is in Indy Next, which is the feeder series below IndyCar, driving for Andretti. And she won a race this year. She's been very competitive. She's like, I think, fifth in the standings. And I know she's getting a proper IndyCar test with Andretti this year. But if there isn't a spot for her in IndyCar with Andretti, not next season, but maybe the season after, maybe she'll be driving for Andretti in Formula E. Who knows?
I was watching what made me think about this is I was watching the women's Olympics, the basketball in the Olympics, the women's basketball.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about all the jokes that get made about women's basketball sucks. And largely, especially if you look historically, it wasn't very good, but it is getting better. And I think the comparison to men is always tough. But in women's basketball specifically, I have two daughters. They're 9 years old and 10 years old. And when did women's basketball start? I don't even know. But they have interest. And I think it's kind of like this chicken and the egg thing with racing and Formula One and stuff like that is you have to encourage a generation to come up because you can't just start racing in Formula E. You can't just take a girl and throw her in the car and be like, all right, now we've got a girl in there. She has to start as a little kid in a cart and come up. She has to do the whole thing. Just like my daughters, if they wanted to play in the WNBA, would have to start right now. Mm-hmm. So I feel like you're still starting to see, or you will see a progression over time of more and more women being in motorsports based on the fact that there are some more women in motorsports, but it has to happen before it's going to inspire a different generation. Cause we've always had men in motorsports. That's easy. it's easy to inspire men to do this. It's all over the place. And I think men have a proclivity towards risk and adventure and danger and things like that. It's kind of built in. But I think there's maybe a point where women have to be inspired a little bit to do it. Where do you think we're at with that? And how do we get to, how do we inspire more, you know, 10-year-old girls, 15-year-old girls to get into doing this so that we have a pool to choose from to even test them to go race?
It's an interesting question. First off, WNBA has been around since 1996. The WNBA and women's college basketball currently is great. It's worth watching. It's fun.
It's gotten way better. I watched my like, wow, this is not awful.
Yeah, I've been to a bunch of LA Sparks games this year. I watched a lot of women's college basketball this year, as well as followed the WNBA this year. It's great. It's exciting. It is as big as it's ever been. It's worth
watching. That 20 years.
It's worth watching. Yeah.
A 20-year growth curve, right?
Yeah. It's worth watching right now. I think it comes down to a mix of the media covering it the same way they cover men's sports and giving it the time, because the reason why everybody started getting into women's basketball in the last few years was because the media started covering it. And once something becomes in the zeitgeist, everybody else wants to be like, hey, what's this about?
But they want to make money. So you're trying to convince these media companies to take a risk. Right?
Yeah, but they started following it and talking about it and saying, oh, like they sold out, you know, they sold out this arena, or they sold out this stadium. Like women's volleyball at the University of Nebraska sold out their football stadium. It was insane. So like the interest is there. You just need the media to properly cover it to keep the momentum that you see in person. If that makes sense. Like you have there's a professional women's hockey league that's going on right now that was like selling out the arenas that they were playing in. And so I think it has to do with the media covering it, content creators covering it. And also what you're talking about is people talking about it to inspire the younger generations. So there's more and more people who want to get into it.
I think the social media is a big part of that too. 100%. Driving all of this. Cause the media would resist and resist and resist because, like I said, I don't think they would want to take a risk. Like if you look at women's basketball in 2000, they wouldn't show it, cover it, nothing, because there was nobody in the stands because most people probably didn't even know it existed. But with social media now, you know, it can be in the algorithm. You could be, if you're a young girl, it's in your algorithm. You're going to see it. You're going to see it and see it. So it doesn't, the media is almost coming. They're almost like the third trailer down the truck coming behind to follow, you know, content creators and social media as things start to get more popular, then they're always behind.
There was a big criticism when F1 Academy came along last year. And then there was also a big criticism about W Series, which was like the predecessor to F1 Academy, saying it was counterproductive to have an all-female single-seater racing series. People were making the arguments like, if women want to get into motorsport, they should go through the proper channels. And they should go start, you know, let's say you're a female driver who wants to drive in Formula One. You should go into karting, and then you should go into Formula Four and make your way through F3, through F2, and then earn your Formula One seat.
That's an oligarch and he's from Argentina.
Exactly. But the counter argument for that was F1 Academy is not to provide a direct ladder series to Formula One. F1 Academy is there explicitly to inspire a younger generation of drivers who are 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, who see this series that's an all-female single-seater racing series and are then inspired to get into karting. It's to expand the number of girls who want to drive, who are currently 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, to give them something to work towards. So 20 years from now, there are more, if not as many women who want to drive as men who want to drive.
Do you want to see women and men in the same series, or are you wanting to see almost like the Olympics is a different series, like a Formula One for women with the same cars, but it's all women. And then a Formula One for men, it's all men.
I want to see women who can drive. And like, you know, people don't love Danica Patrick, but Danica Patrick drove an IndyCar in NASCAR. We currently have Catherine Legg, who has been in and out of IndyCar for years, who like is a very talented driver. And when Catherine Legg is not driving an IndyCar, she drove in the Indy 500 the last 2 years. She's driven several races in IndyCar this year. She, I believe, drives an IMSA when she's not doing IndyCar. You have a lot of female drivers in Formula One who have tested before and have had very competitive times. Susie Wolf, who is the head of F1 Academy and was also the team principal in Formula E for, I believe, Venturi, and who also happens to be married to Toto Wolff, was a very talented driver who was in, and was a test driver for Williams. You had Jessica Hawkins, who is a test driver for Aston Martin. You have Bianca Bustamante, who is an F1 Academy driver who has tested for McLaren. You have a lot of really talented female drivers who have shown they can drive a Formula One car and their times are competitive. I just think we might be a few years away from finding that driver who is competitive enough to earn that seat on merit, but we're getting there.
Yeah. I mean, it is a meritocracy, right? At the end, in the end, the clock is the ultimate meritocracy, right? Either you can do it or you can't.
Yeah.
I think we're always, there's always going to be a barrier of what women and men choose to do. Right. I mean, it's just, I think it's like, and maybe we'll evolve beyond it, but right now it just seems like we have like this, whether it's a cultural or maybe it's even a physiological thing of what women and men perceive they are capable of or what they're actually capable of. Uh-huh. It could be either one that's holding anybody back.
I think it's a perception. I think women are capable of driving in motorsport and being competitive. It's just, you don't want to put somebody in that seat who isn't ready to compete. You don't want to put a woman in a seat in Formula One just because she's a woman and then ever finish at the back of the grid at every race. That's the last thing.
Just be embarrassed.
You want.
Yeah, you don't want to do that.
Like, there's a very competitive driver right now. I believe she's in F2, Sophia Flörsch. She's a German driver. She was very competitive in F3 last year. There's a number of, there's a 18-year-old driver in Super Formula. Her name's Juju Noda. Some people think she might have been thrust into Super Formula a little early, but she's a very talented driver who's still very young. There's, of course,
we're watching Leah Block come up a little bit. She's been doing some good work.
Yeah. And she's very competitive, very talented. You have Dorian Penn, who drives in F1 Academy, who also drives for Iron Dames, who's very young, very competitive.
We had someone on from the Iron Dames. She was a Le Mans driver.
Was it Sarah Bovey? Michelle Gadding?
Michelle Gadding. Yeah, she was on a while back. Yeah.
Cool.
She's great. She's awesome.
Iron Dames are so badass. That is such a cool team and a cool concept. I will be an Iron Dames fan forever. I always, whenever there's a WEC race going on, I'm they're one of the cars I'm always following.
Yeah, those gals kill it. Absolutely. Well, dude, I appreciate you coming to hang out with us. It's a good time.
Yeah.
And maybe I'll try and pay attention next year, and then I'll have you on again, and we can have Formula One talk. If you ever need a guest host too that wants to come on and not know what the fuck he's talking about, I can always do that too, and be a foil for being an absolute idiot when it comes to Formula One.
Yeah. Thanks so much for having me. This was super fun.
All right, man. Take care of yourself.
You too. Bye.